It's my last night here in Jamaica. Sun's setting, about to lose time here on the old camera, but I just wanted to say, the episode you're about to watch is with one of my favorite clients and literally one of the nicest guys you'll meet in the pest control industry, Jacob Borg. And Jacob built Point Pest Control of the Pacific Northwest literally from scratch. It was a one-man operation. Took it almost up to $36 million before he and Gabe, his partner, sold it to Thompson Street's Pesco platform. Jacob and I had been talking about Jamaica for quite a bit. You know, I live in the Caribbean. I live in Puerto Rico, which is a very, very different place from Jamaica, and I'd never been here before. And now that I'm here, I mean, Jamaican people are literally some of the nicest people I've ever met. Warm, friendly people. The vegetation here is awesome. The fruits, the beach, as you can see, is spectacular. I really enjoyed my time here in Jamaica, especially with Jacob Borg, who literally is more Jamaican than American. I've never met somebody who's not Jamaican, who knows so much about the food, the culture, the language. Yes, the language. There's patois here, which is a language.
What? Yadi, man. Me not hear you yet.
Foundation.
Yeah, man. Foundation. Yadi.
In 3 days with Jacob Borg, I've covered the majority of the country, and I've got to see things that I never would have been able to see on my own. So I'm glad Jacob was able to meet me down here and we were able to take this tour. It was a very, very special time. Not only spending time with Jacob, but also spending time here in Jamaica. So, appreciate you joining me. Sit back and relax and watch Jacob Borg's Jamaica. We arrived in Kingston on Sunday afternoon, and through a YPO connection, we were able to get Jacob face-to-face for an interview with one of his favorite reggae singers, Grammy-nominated Jesse Royal.
I'm a huge reggae fan, and yeah. I'm sitting here in Kingston, Jamaica with Jesse Royal. It's like amazing.
Yeah. It's a pleasure, man. But that's also the beauty of Jamaica. And you can go down the road and you might happen to see Stephen Marley.
My connection with Jamaica is kind of interesting. I had a teacher in junior high teaching me about all these different countries. One of them was Jamaica. And I remember for some reason, we were learning about Ziggy Marley and the Melody Makers in school.
Yeah.
Maybe because she was a fan or something. And so I was a huge reggae fan.
Ziggy Marley,
early. I was like in junior high or something.
Whoa.
And people always ask me why I love Jamaica, and I'm a fan of Jamaica. I mean, I lived here for a few years and have been back many times, but I was here in 94 to 96.
Okay.
And one of my memories in 96 in Kingston was that was like right after Till Shiloh came out.
Oh.
And so Buju's, that album was everywhere.
Yeah, man. As a youth, I can tell you, I remember that being stuck in my father's tape deck, I think it was at the time,
Yeah,
my father's tape deck, it stuck.
Yep.
Like, it was like, I remember four...
So you grew up on
there
that.
There was four things on repeat. Till Shiloh, Bob Marley, Legend.
Yeah.
Muta Baruka, and Peter Tosh. The music is just a manifestation of the life.
Streets watching people keep eavesdropping. See it happen, but not telling the beast nothing.
Lots of people that come to Jamaica come on a cruise and they're here for one day.
Yeah.
And it's just some people's experience is mixed. When you come to Jamaica and you live here and you get to experience it, it's totally different.
Yeah, and to me, a day in Jamaica is like there's no way for you to really feel. And I tell people, the hotels are incredible. But that's not all, right?
Yeah.
So there's that. And then there's the other Jamaica that makes Jamaica, like the heartbeat of Jamaica.
Like for me, I would say part of that is this concept of the country, like getting out in the country.
And the beauty of Jamaica, you can get a little bit of everything.
Right.
You want to go to the beach, you can get that. You want to go to the river, you can get that. You want to go to the mountains, you can get that.
I'm never leaving, man.
Some of the freshest food.
The more you talk, I'm like, what am I doing?
Think about it. Some of the freshest food you can get in the world. Yeah, some of the nicest people you'll ever meet.
After a great time with Jesse, we were famished. So Jacob took us out to Red Hills Road in Kingston for some mouthwatering jerk chicken.
You see it?
That's your.
After you get the chicken, you get a red strap.
All right.
We needed to fuel up for the next day's voyage to Montego Bay. Right now we're in Montego Bay. Yep. You know this neighborhood like the back of your hand. How much time did you spend over here?
Montego Bay, I was here for about 6 months.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, where we're sitting right now, like when I had a day off when I was here, we would come down here and
eat
bun and cheese, you know, and check out the sights, watch the sunset. Mm-hmm. The airport is right around the corner from us. When you're in Jamaica, bun and cheese is kind of a staple.
Mm-hmm.
So you just stick a slice of cheese in there.
Mm-hmm.
You got to get the right amount of cheese in each bite, you know, not too much, not too
little. Okay.
There you go. Spice bun and cheese. Not bad, huh?
It's not bad.
Would you eat it regularly?
No.
No.
When you left Jamaica as a missionary, did you get immediately into pests then? I don't think you did.
Oh man. So I actually got my start doing pest control in Jamaica.
In Jamaica?
Yeah. So
really?
It's crazy that we're, this is true, like, yeah. Oh, no, I wasn't knocking doors, spraying homes. No,
okay.
No. I lived in a small house in Mona Heights.
Okay.
And I was probably in Jamaica for like a couple months. And I was like living off of bread. Like I didn't have that much money. I was kind of new.
Not even cheese, just the bread.
Just the bread. Okay. This is how bad it was. But I was getting used to the exchange rate and how much money I was going to have. And I ate a lot of bread. I started waking up in the morning and there would be giant chunks taken out of my bread. Like massive chunks. And at first I was like, what bug is doing this? Like, this is weird. And then I think at some point or another, I figured out that it was not a bug, it was rats.
Oh.
Or a rat.
Okay.
So then I took my bread and I like thought I would outsmart the rat and I put it in the oven and shut the oven.
Okay.
But there were still chunks taken out of my bread the next day. I'm like, what?
So the rat was getting in the oven.
The rat was getting on top of the freezer, and it was like wherever I put the bread. I got my machete, and I heard a noise one night, and I turned on a light and ran out there, and this rat comes running towards the exit, and I went to swing at it, and instead of slicing it with the blade, I turned the machete flat, and hit
it,
right in the I hit it hard.
Okay.
I got it. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. It went and died in one of my housemate's drawers.
And this is when you were a missionary.
Yeah. 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 So that was my first, the first time I ever killed a rat.
And then you said, I'm getting into pest control. This is what I love this. I want to kill rats.
Yeah.
Yeah. I want to kill rats.
Not quite.
Man.
But when I came back after I spent 2 years in Jamaica, I met some guys that were selling pest control. And recruiting students to sell pest control. Some of my friends were motivated college students that wanted to make money and wanted to figure out how to get ahead. And so we signed up to sell pest control door to door in California.
Mm-hmm.
And the company that I worked for, the first summer I ever sold pest control, was called Aspen Pest Management.
Okay.
And like they closed after like 6 weeks.
Did you get your back end?
No, it was a total flop. I left halfway through the summer, they farmed us off to Boise, and I worked for Terminix for a few weeks, made a little bit of money, and at the end of the summer, I said, I'm never doing that again. And my goal was I was going to go to Alaska, work on a fishing boat, I was going to find a way to make money, and it wasn't going to be doing that.
Okay.
And I've been doing pest control basically ever since.
So what'd you do, though? You said, I'm not going to do that.
I wasn't going to do it, yeah.
So then what happened?
So I met a really good friend of mine, Aaron Peterson, and a guy named Darren Philippi. And those guys worked for a company called Eclipse Marketing. And Eclipse represented Orkin. I was like motivated. I'd already done it one summer and had kind of a crappy experience. And so I was like, this has got to happen.
How much did you make that summer? Do you remember?
Like 30 grand, maybe.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, at the time, that was like... Yeah, it was...
What were commission rates back in those days?
I know that I got like $50 up front.
Okay.
I bet the total rate that I got was maybe 25%.
Wow.
Total. Maybe.
The second year, what company were you selling for? Orkin again?
That was Eclipse and Orkin.
Okay.
Yep. So I went to Florida. Then I went to Louisiana. That was Orkin and Eclipse. And then I went to Virginia. And that's when I recruited Jared and Kyle. So my brother came with me to Richmond, Virginia.
What sort of delinquent was your brother back in those days?
Oh, man. Like, at that time, he was just, like, we were young, man.
Yeah.
We were young. All of us were, you know. Yeah. I don't know if I would describe him as a delinquent. But we had a good time that summer. It was, I mean, that summer, to keep that summer going and pull that off, like, what we did was, it was tough. For 2 years, I just saved the money from selling. And then after that, I opened Point in Spokane and have grown it into, you know, Idaho, Washington, Oregon, Montana.
So everything for you grew from Spokane.
Yep.
How big was that at that point in time?
Was it a small it was like office, no? At the time, I mean, 2000, I mean, the first summer we sold, you know, it was like 2007. And so we started the company during the worst economy since the Great Depression. Like, yeah. It was crappy.
Yeah.
It was hard. And we were about 7 years in before Gabe and I decided to really expand and grow more aggressively. So.
And what year did you partner up with Gabe?
It was 2015. When we decided to go into business together, we were expanding to Oregon. And he became, you know, basically him and I were, you know, partners on everything that we did outside of what I'd originally built. And so yeah. We now have we call it Point Marketing. But that company is what we built our direct sales force under. And so Gabe's really the instrumental guy behind helping with that.
What was the last year that you officially did not, that you were done knocking on the doors?
Me yourself? Personally?
Yes.
Oh, man. I knocked doors in Spokane, in Tri-Cities, and Lewiston, probably till like a year before Gabe and I. Like, I knocked doors probably in 2014.
Okay.
Once Gabe came on and he took over our direct sales program, it was pretty rare for me to, like, knock doors after that.
Do you miss it?
Sometimes. Actually, oddly, sometimes.
Yeah?
Yeah. I mean, life was somewhat simple when the only obligation was to go get the next account.
Yeah.
I mean, I had, you know, a small business that I was coordinating, but selling in some ways, it's really difficult, but there's some simplicity to just, like, that's all I had to do.
Yeah.
My life's way more complicated now, you know?
Well, who was running the business then when you were doing that?
Me, I mean, like, early on, the phone would ring and it would be me answering, you know? It took some work to figure out how to scale and remove myself from, you know, each part of the process.
So what was that trajectory like, though, when you know, you're knocking doors, you're putting on accounts, you're running the business. I mean, how did you replace yourself in the org chart?
I plugged in CSRs, technicians right away, a service supervisor right away. Like, from the beginning, I built Point so that whether I did direct sales or not, I could generate leads and close leads and have a traditional sales and marketing program to grow the business. So, yeah. Man, it's, I'm like looking behind us, like there's a cruise ship, sun setting, it's amazing.
So this is Montego Bay over here.
Yeah. Yeah, they call it Mo Bay for short. And it's in St. James is the parish.
Yeah.
But yeah, this has been perfect. I'm gonna take you to a couple more spots tonight.
Yeah.
We're gonna walk down towards the Hip Strip. And
the Hip Strip?
Yeah, that's what
they call it. Take our buns and cheese, head out to the Hip Strip.
I think it's called Jimmy Cliff Avenue. Do you know who Jimmy Cliff is?
No.
Famous reggae singer.
Of course. I figured you'd know. Let's roll on out.
All right. We drove up the Hip Strip. We're now at the Jerk Stands, kind of at the end of the strip before you go downtown. And we're gonna walk around a little bit and eat some jerk chicken. What are you doing?
Rasta kid.
Rasta kid?
Okay. All right. Yeah, Yadi, man.
Me not here yet.
The foundation.
Man. Yeah, man. Foundation. Yadi.
Hey, you know
Yadi. Yeah. He's a Yadi.
Is you a missionary?
No. Come on, I hear that. He says I'm a Yadi.
Oh.
Yeah, that's like the best compliment. This is gonna make my teeth rot out.
No.
All right. I'm gonna suck on.
Some good sugar cane.
So good, huh? Mm-hmm. It's actually tasty, dude. This is better.
This is ours?
Yeah. Come on, respect.
Cheers. All right, man.
We'll give them some. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yardie.
All right, Yardie, let's go.
All right.
Yeah.
Hey.
Cheers.
Cheers, buddy. That's so good. All right.
Thanks, man.
Next time, all right? Respect. The best soup. What is it?
Sit.
No meat.
No meat.
No meat.
Yeah, not sure.
You're vegetarian?
No.
How long have you had this here?
30 years.
30? For real?
30 years.
The real soup, man. Legend.
Yeah?
For real? You come here all the time?
Yeah, man.
How often?
4 out of 10 years, I made it for me.
Really?
Yeah. Is it the same soup every day?
Sip. We are growing soup.
If you want soup, you go to the station. This is sip.
Yeah, this is sip.
Sip.
No meat.
Sip. No meat.
No vegetable.
Yeah.
Not child.
All right.
No flesh eating.
They don't cry,
you know?
Yeah. They don't eat anything that's going to cry.
They don't cry.
Yeah. Can I have one cup? You want a cup?
No.
Yep.
Let me know. He's
a soup guy.
I'll have it. If you had chicken,
would
you?
I ate chicken.
I like chicken for two. Hey. I want some sip.
Vampire.
No, I'm a vampire.
You like to eat chicken?
Bust a lot of bone.
Bust a lot of bone.
Jawbone.
So what's in the soup? Is it a secret?
Coconut.
Breadfruit, carrot. Oh, man. This is a progressive dinner.
Well, you know what? I'm gonna have to have a soup.
You should have one.
I'll have a soup.
It looks good, huh?
Yeah. That's it, man.
All right.
You don't want to give me a toast. I'm not proud.
Take the 1,000.
Come here.
Dude, that's good, dude. So good. I need it to cool off, dude. It is hot.
I know.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's good.
It's good, though. I like it.
Yeah, dude. It's got some flavors. It's so good, dude.
That's your mom, huh?
Yeah. What?
These are gummy bears.
That is the best.
That's the best? Oh, you know, I don't like green that much. I'll take this one. Cheers. Thank you.
That is so good, dude.
This Mobe jerk is better than the Kingston jerk.
This is legit better, dude.
Yeah.
Did you already try the festival?
I like the festival. It's like a festival in my mouth.
That's exactly what they say here, dude. This is the best meal I've probably eaten since I've been here.
You like it, huh?
That is so good. They don't make chicken like this where I come from.
No.
No. You can't do this in Idaho. Come buy food on the street. This is amazing.
How long have you been cooking chicken for?
Last year.
Oh, that's it. Okay. How much will we owe you for the jerk?
$10.
Okay. Good and clean. And the beard. Get the chicken out of the beard.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you so much.
That was amazing.
Respect.
Have a great night. Thank you. Respect.
Cheers. Yum.
Bye-bye. Jacob, I've been in Jamaica, 48 hours?
Yeah.
I came into Kingston. You sat down with Jesse.
Yep.
We cruised out to St. Anne. Then Ocho Rios, now we're in Montego Bay.
Yep.
What's your favorite part of this country, though?
Oh, man. I love Kingston. I love the city.
Yeah.
I love getting away from the tourist stuff.
Yeah.
And I love the whole island, really. Like, I can appreciate the whole thing, but I like Kingston a lot. Yeah. Although, we're in Montego Bay, and we just did some really cool stuff.
I would say the street food
was
awesome here.
Yeah.
Everything was.
Yeah.
So back around the time Gabe joined Point, how big of a company was it
in
terms of revenue? Do you remember back then?
Maybe like a $4.5 million company, maybe five.
How did you deal with the complexity going from like a $4 million business to pushing almost a $40 million business?
So the first 7 years that we were in business, mm-hmm. Our growth rate was not what it was after Gabe joined us. And we built like a foundation that was really good. So I had really good, amazing people on my team, people that are still with us now,
yeah.
Really at It started with some of the key managers that we had. They did a good job of perpetuating the culture that we wanted.
How did you recruit these sorts of people?
Most of them were referrals. Like, I got to a point where I really hated advertising for jobs. I know you can find good people when you do that.
Yeah.
But when I knew I wanted someone, I talked about it out loud in front of people I was around. I thought about it. I kind of lived this kind of goofy secret, the secret, you know, like I just put it in the universe.
You put it out there.
And I freaking just drove towards it.
Is that how you got married? You just put
it
out there?
Oh, man, it sounds so goofy, but one of my key managers, Dave Eisenberger, he was a referral from an ex-manager at Eclipse Marketing. And I got a message on Facebook once that said, hey, this guy I know is looking for work. I think he's great. And he's been incredible to work with. Greg C., who I work with, who's incredible. I knew him personally, and he overheard me talking to someone that was a technician working for me, just in passing, that I was looking for a manager. And he called me the next day and said, hey, I overheard you. I don't know if I'd call it happenstance. It was meant to be, man. That's pretty rad.
You mentioned, you know, one of the key ingredients to your growth was hiring good people, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, when I think about it, I mean, at the end of the day, you're still the CEO and you ultimately got to 280 people. That's not just simply hiring good people.
Right.
That's being an architect of the business. So, I mean, what are some of the things that stood out in your mind that actually helped you do that?
Yeah, yeah. It was interesting because there was thresholds like throughout the whole business that I experienced where I'd get to a certain threshold and I'd recognize that two things needed to happen. I needed a better system, or I needed a different person or another person.
Okay.
And so a lot of the path to continue to expand and grow, there was geographic growth, but there was also growth with what services we would offer. We decided at one point, okay, we need to be experts in termite service. So we had to solve those things. I was at a gas station the other day and someone I know saw me and I was on my phone and this person that saw me was familiar that I'd, you know, been through this transaction. And a lot of people make big assumptions about these things. I'm still working pretty much the same. But he saw me at a gas station on the phone in the middle of the day and he said, must be nice.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking to myself, well, no one really said that to me when I quit my job and had nothing except a truck and hope.
Yeah.
And so I went through the ringer, man. I studied hard. I asked lots of questions all the time. I mean, when I worked in Orkin branches, when I was selling pest control for Eclipse, I got to know everything about what they did, why they did it. I asked questions. I wrote stuff down. I mean, I was a sponge, even though at the time that wasn't really the thing that I thought would be my career. But I wanted to understand what they did, why they did. I was a curious person to a level that lots of people probably aren't.
You know, now that you're a partner in Pesco, I mean, do you like the feeling of still having skin in the game a point?
Oh yeah, for sure, for sure. I mean, the part is because I care so much about the people that I work with. I want to be helpful. And the Pesco team's amazing. They have a huge group of really talented people. They've got some different companies, some different brands. Yeah. They're listening to me. We're talking about, you know, changes. We're collaborating. They're a good group, so.
What do you think is next for you?
Well, so right now, I'm unwinding some of my day-to-day stuff from Point. I mean, I was really have been acting CFO and managing the finances of a high growth company and all the stuff that we had to do to pull that off is complicated. So I'm happy to be unraveling from the finance side of what we do. A lot of the other stuff that I'm unraveling is being over service, anything service related, operation related. I'm still helping with as much sales related items as possible, just trying to be useful for them. Mm-hmm. So what's next? I hope to continue to just help as they need it. And I'm moving.
Yeah.
I've lived in North Idaho for almost 20 years and I'm...
So you're moving to mid-Idaho?
I'm moving to kind of eastern Idaho.
Okay.
a town called Driggs, Idaho, which is near Jackson Hole, Wyoming.
Sounds about as fun as Jamaica.
Yeah, yeah. I'm here going, man, I should be moving to Jamaica.
I should be, man.
At least have a, you know.
You got to do it.
Condo here or something.
Yeah.
Sounds amazing.
Yeah. You got to do it. You've been coming to Jamaica for the most part since you were a missionary here.
Yeah, yeah. Yep.
I mean, has it been almost every year?
No, no, no. So when I was here from 94 to 96, mm-hmm. I came home. It's, you know, when you're young, you're kind of naive. Yeah. I don't know that I ever thought I'd even be able to come back. I mean, I had nothing.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I didn't have any money. My family didn't have like a bunch of money that they were going to just go, oh, like go back to Jamaica whenever you want. So, and when I came to Jamaica as a missionary, it was the first airplane I'd ever taken.
Wow.
My family did amazing things growing up, but we didn't fly places, you know. There was six kids, like yeah. expensive, you know.
Yeah.
And so I don't know that it was hard to leave at the time because I didn't know that I'd ever come back. And so I grinded for a long time to just have the financial capabilities to come back. And so it's really been like the last like 10 years that I've made some trips back.
I see.
And so, yeah, for the first like 15 years that I was home, like I didn't make it back at all.
I can't believe like literally a week ago, this was even on the schedule and here we are.
Right, right.
It's actually super fun coming to a country where you're with somebody that knows so much about the culture, the food.
I love it here, man. Yeah. Awesome. It's been way good, man.
It has been.
Yeah, it's yeah. Been awesome. We need to do it again. Yes, respect.
Respect.
Yeah. All right, all right.